In June 1942, the most decisive naval battle of the Second World War was fought between the United States of America and the Japanese Empire. Waged entirely by aircraft carriers, hundreds of miles apart, the Battle of Midway was the first major fleet encounter in which the ships on each side never came within visual range of enemy vessels. Victory or defeat depended not on the big guns of battleships, but on carrier-borne bombers and torpedo bombers flying over vast tracts of ocean to seek and destroy their targets. Midway was the dawn of a new era in naval warfare. For Japan, the Battle of Midway was intended to be the linchpin of a great campaign to extend the frontiers of the empire far into the Pacific. Midway Island, a vital American outpost, was to be attacked and invaded, and the United States Pacific Fleet, sailing to its defense with America's few precious aircraft carriers, would be ambushed and destroyed. If the remnants of American naval power were finally broken, Japanese mastery of the Pacific could never again be challenged. In fact, in the Battle of Midway, the Japanese carrier fleet, the mightiest in existence, was utterly destroyed, and Japan suffered her greatest defeat for over 300 years. At Midway, Japan, at the height of her military power, lost not only a major naval engagement, but in a single day, doomed the Japanese Empire to ruin and defeat. Since the early 1930s, Japanese conquests in China had caused ever-increasing friction with the United States. From mid-1940, the Americans had banned exports of arms, scrap iron, and other strategic materials to the Japanese Empire. Then, in July 1941, America led an international oil embargo and froze all Japanese overseas assets. The effect was devastating. Up to now, 90% of Japan's oil had been imported, and her stockpiles were rapidly dwindling. With time running out, a fateful decision was taken by the Japanese leadership: to invade and conquer neighboring territories rich in oil and other raw materials. First, a major obstacle would have to be eliminated: the American Pacific Fleet, anchored at Hawaii. Just before dawn on the morning of December the 7th, 1941, 360 bombers and fighters were launched from Japanese aircraft carriers 230 miles north of Hawaii. Their target was the three carriers and the eight battleships of the United States Pacific Fleet based at Pearl Harbor. Within 2 hours, 18 American warships, including 6 battleships, were sunk, and 90 more vessels were damaged by bombs or torpedoes. Almost 200 planes were destroyed on the ground, and over 3,500 US personnel killed or wounded. The Japanese lost only 29 aircraft. It was a stunning victory. Shortly after noon the next day, the United States declared war on the Japanese Empire. With the destruction of the US Pacific Fleet, the way was open for the Japanese campaign of conquest. Garrisons throughout the region had already been secretly strengthened, and thousands of troops assembled in preparation for the onslaught. Hours after the raid on Pearl Harbor, Japanese planes attacked American air bases on Wake Island, Guam, and Luzon in the Philippines. With complete air superiority, the Japanese launched their invasions. Forces in French Indochina, already held by the Japanese, rapidly advanced into Thailand and Burma. Troops from the island of Hainan landed in Malaya. The same day, an advanced raiding force invaded the Philippines and was soon followed by landings in strength. Over the next 3 weeks, Wake Island and Hong Kong fell to the Japanese. Borneo and Celeb were invaded, and Sumatra was occupied. On February the 19th, Japanese aircraft carriers launched a lightning raid on Port Darwin in northern Australia, sinking 12 merchant ships and eliminating Darwin as a valuable Allied base. Early March saw the climax of the Japanese expansion, the inevitable occupation of Java. In a little over 3 months, Japan had conquered a quarter of the Pacific Ocean. By securing a steady supply of oil and widening the defensive perimeter of the homeland, Japan had achieved all her immediate war aims. Yet in spite of the breathtaking scale of the Japanese victories, there did remain one major threat to the security of her Pacific conquests. Three aircraft carriers of the United States Pacific Fleet had escaped the carnage of Pearl Harbor, and within weeks, they had each become the nucleus of a new task force. After minor raids on the Marshall and Gilbert Islands, two of the American carriers set sail on one of the most audacious missions of the Pacific War, to bomb Tokyo, the heart of the Japanese Empire. Early in April 1942, the aircraft carrier Hornet headed west from the US naval base at Alameda in California to rendezvous with sister ship Enterprise sailing from Pearl Harbor. Skillfully avoiding the protective chain of Japanese-held islands, Hornet and Enterprise penetrated to within 825 miles of the coast of Japan. At 0824, on the 18th of April, 16 Mitchells took off from Hornet and struck a course for the Japanese capital. Flying low, they avoided Japan's fighter defenses, and 15 aircraft dropped their bombs on the city. All but one of the Mitchells escaped to safety in mainland China or Russia. In the wake of the attack that became known after its commander as the Doolittle Raid, there was consternation amongst Japanese military leaders. Although the raid had caused only minor material damage, it had struck an immense blow to Japan's national pride. The need to protect the emperor was at the very core of the armed forces being, and an agony of shame swept through the high command. Japan's leaders quickly concluded that there was only one way in which the homeland and the emperor could be adequately protected. The frontiers of the empire must be pushed even further into the Pacific. In October 1941, General Hideki Tojo had been appointed Prime Minister of Imperial Japan. As Army Chief of Staff, Tojo's greatest ambition was to see a successful conclusion to the Japanese campaign in China, and he was convinced that the only possible way of achieving this was to win a sharp victory over the Western powers. On his appointment as Prime Minister, General Tojo had kept his post as Chief of Staff and the job of War Minister. However, although an immensely powerful figure, Tojo did not have complete control of government policy. In a cabinet in which all the armed forces were represented, he could count only on the support of the army, and most decisions were ultimately a compromise between army and navy. Even before the Doolittle Raid, extending the perimeter of the empire into the Pacific had been a cherished ambition of an influential naval faction. After the raid, arguments between the army and navy evaporated. Because the proposed operation would demand little army participation, Tojo finally gave his support. Franklin Delano Roosevelt had been elected President of the United States in 1932. Deeply opposed to the general mood of isolationism, Roosevelt believed that America should play an active role on the world stage. Even before the outbreak of war in Europe, Roosevelt had warned of the dangers posed by Nazi Germany's ambitions. After the German conquest of the continent in 1940, Roosevelt, in spite of domestic opposition, increasingly supported Britain in her struggle for survival. It was also Roosevelt who, in retaliation for Japanese actions against China, had imposed the oil and trade embargo on Japan. As a former Assistant Secretary to the Navy, and now as its Commander-in-Chief, Roosevelt took a special interest in the service. He chose his own flag and staff officers and was so determined that the Navy should be run by the best man for the job that he even selected a member of the opposition Republican Party, Frank Knox, to head the Navy Department. Under Roosevelt and Knox, the naval budget steadily rose. Even after Pearl Harbor, Roosevelt believed, contrary to the wishes of the American public, that the war in Europe should be given priority over actions in the Pacific. He understood that enormous resources would be needed to push back the tide of Japanese conquests. And until the full might of American industry could be brought to bear, the United States would have to concentrate on holding the line. Roosevelt insisted that further Japanese expansion must be countered at all costs. The extension of the Japanese defensive perimeter in the Pacific, although logistically complex, was expected by the Imperial High Command to pose few real problems. On the islands to be invaded, enemy forces were weak, and at sea, it seemed there was little to fear from the Americans or the British. The Japanese Navy, the driving force behind the plan, was supremely confident. The first stage of the Japanese plan of conquest was to complete the occupation of New Guinea. By April 1942, New Guinea had already been partly conquered, and the Japanese were anxious to deny the whole island to the Allies. An advanced striking force of troop transports and heavy cruisers would be assembled in Rabaul, along with three aircraft carriers at Truk. The force from Rabaul would sail south, then split into two divisions. The first was to seize Tulagi and the Solomon Islands. The second, supported by one aircraft carrier from Truk, was to capture Port Moresby. The remaining two carriers would enter the Coral Sea and engage any enemy found there. Once New Guinea had been occupied, then New Caledonia, Fiji, and Samoa would easily be captured. To extend the Japanese line in the north, three islands of the Aleutian chain, Attu, Kiska, and Adak, would be added to the list of conquests. The next stage in the Japanese advance would be the occupation of the American-held island of Midway, 1,136 miles west of Hawaii. The capture of Midway would win for the Empire an airstrip within striking distance of the American naval base at Pearl Harbor. Although the capture of Midway would provide a vital stepping stone in any future action against Hawaii, the operation would also have another equally important objective. It would be used to lure American aircraft carriers out of Pearl Harbor and force them to fight a battle that would end in their destruction. The plan to capture Midway and defeat the American carrier fleet was a complex and intricate combination of invasion, diversionary action, and ambush. The first step in the Midway offensive would be the dispatch of a Japanese submarine fleet to set up two reconnaissance cordons, one 500 miles west of Pearl Harbor and the other between Hawaii and Midway. While the submarines were taking up their positions, a Midway occupation force, consisting of troop ships supported by a heavy cruiser division, would set out from the Marianas and head northeast towards Midway. To destroy Midway's defenses and ambush the American carrier fleet, a carrier strike force was assembled, made up of four aircraft carriers, supported by battleships, heavy cruisers, and a powerful destroyer screen. The carriers and their support would sortie east through the Bungo Channel. They would be followed by a main force of six battleships. To the north, the Aleutian Islands would be attacked by a second task force of carriers and transports, escorted by cruisers, destroyers, and battleships. The Aleutians' operation had a secondary purpose. It would divert the Americans from the impending attack on Midway, tempting them to send a carrier north. To intercept any US warships dispatched from Pearl Harbor, the Japanese fleet would be redeployed to lie in wait. To the south, the Japanese carrier strike force would approach to within 250 miles of Midway and attack the airfield, hangars, and shore installations. The invasion would quickly follow. As the Midway landings were in progress, the carrier strike force and the main force battleships, redeployed 500 miles from the island, would lie in wait. When the Americans sailed from Pearl Harbor and were detected by the submarine cordon around Hawaii, or long-range reconnaissance patrols flying from the Marshall Islands, the Japanese carriers would engage. The big guns of the main force battleships would then finish the remnants of American sea power in the Pacific. By the spring of 1942, the Japanese Navy code, JN-25, had been partly broken by US naval intelligence. However, the cipher was complex, and many messages still remained difficult to understand. Commander Joseph Rochefort was head of the Naval Communications Intelligence Unit at Pearl Harbor. It was Rochefort who finally succeeded in adding a piece of the cipher jigsaw vital to the Midway operation. By early May, from partially decoded Japanese messages, Rochefort was sure a big attack was planned for Midway. But confirmation was difficult, and other interpretations were possible. The code that the Japanese used to represent the island was unknown, but was suspected to be the letters AF. Rochefort designed a simple ruse, which was given the go-ahead by his superiors. Midway has no natural fresh water supply, so Rochefort arranged for the island to send an urgent request for a freshwater tanker. 2 days later, on the 12th of May, an American listening post picked up a Japanese radio message: AF is short of water. It was clear that coded messages referring to an attack on AF meant that Midway was the true objective of Japan's coming operation. Already, the Japanese plan was fatally compromised. Although the Americans would be heavily outnumbered in the coming battle, thanks to the codebreakers at Pearl Harbor, they could at least now estimate the probable date of the attack to within a few days, somewhere between the 4th and the 8th of June. Knowing that the Japanese invasion of the Aleutians was merely a feint, the Pacific Fleet could afford to concentrate its strongest naval force in the Midway area. Furthermore, because they knew that Japanese aircraft carriers would be lying in wait, the Americans could ignore the actual invasion force and go all out for the enemy carriers. The United States had a precious asset in the island of Midway itself: dive bombers, torpedo bombers, and even heavy B-17s could be stationed there to attack the Japanese fleet. As an unsinkable airbase, the island would be invaluable as an emergency landing strip for carrier aircraft, crippled or running low on fuel. In addition, Midway had two old but powerful radars, which could be used to help detect and track Japanese attacks. The United States naval plan to counter the Japanese operation against Midway was carefully designed to make full use of every advantage the Americans possessed. The American defense of Midway would hinge on the ability of two carrier task forces to find and destroy the Japanese fleet. Task Force 16, based around the carriers Enterprise and Hornet, would be first to sail from Pearl Harbor. Task Force 17, with the carrier Yorktown, would follow 2 days later. The three carriers would rendezvous at Point Luck, 325 miles northeast of Midway. As the Japanese carrier strike force approached the area, the problem for the Americans would be finding it. The radar on American carriers had a range of only 150 miles, and if the carrier's own reconnaissance patrols failed to make contact, then the fleet would have to rely on long-range aircraft based on Midway Island. Midway's reconnaissance Catalinas would fly 700 miles out to sea in search of the Japanese. If the enemy fleet was discovered, then the Catalinas would track it until it was within range of the Midway radar station. Midway radar would then keep the pursuing American carriers fully informed. An all-out attack of land and carrier-based aircraft could then be accurately vectored in to destroy the Japanese strike force. Admiral Isoroku Yamamoto, author of the plan to defeat the United States Navy at Midway, had been appointed Commander-in-Chief of the Japanese Combined Fleet in 1939. A dynamic and powerful personality, Yamamoto had little regard for the abilities of his superiors, and he was well aware that they were intimidated by his standing and his track record. Yamamoto's devastating success as the mastermind of the Pearl Harbor raid and the Pacific victories which followed gave him almost a free hand in designing and implementing offensive strategies. So determined was Yamamoto to have his own way that he frequently threatened to resign if his plans were not accepted. In his youth, Yamamoto had studied at Harvard University and as a graduate had served in Washington as naval attaché. Knowing the United States intimately, Yamamoto greatly feared America's industrial might. Before Pearl Harbor, he had tried to convince his superiors of the risk Japan faced in any lengthy conflict with the United States. However, once he realized that Japan was committed to war, Yamamoto was determined to win it his way. The destruction of the American fleet at Midway would buy Japan much-needed time. Yamamoto's dream was the Kasan Kantai, the great decisive battle, which would force the Americans to negotiate a peace. He understood that a fleet engagement was a reckless gamble, but as an inveterate poker and shogi player, he was convinced that the only possibility of victory lay in staking everything on just one card. Admiral Chester Nimitz, a gifted strategist and organizer, had been appointed Commander-in-Chief of the U.S. Pacific Fleet on the 31st of December, 1941, immediately after the Japanese raid on Pearl Harbor. Nimitz believed that the Pearl Harbor disaster had not been the result of incompetence, and his subsequent policy of retaining all officers in their posts did much to raise morale in the American Pacific Fleet. Nimitz's personable style of management, plus a remarkable gift for trusting subordinates to do their jobs without interference, would prove crucial in the battle ahead. After Pearl Harbor, it was Chester Nimitz who had realized that the era of the big gun battleship was over, and that the striking power of America's Navy would in future be built around the aircraft carrier. While under Nimitz's direction, America's carrier building program was accelerated. For the moment, he would have to make do with what he had, just four aircraft carriers and their support ships. In spite of his slender resources, Nimitz would stick to the tactical doctrine he had always advocated. For aircraft carriers, attack is the best form of defense. To the Japanese Navy, the outcome of the forthcoming battle was never in doubt. So far, the war had yielded an unbroken string of successes, and the certainty of victory was shared by all ranks. Such was the level of confidence that there was a real fear amongst some flag officers that the Americans would not dare fight and would refuse to leave the safety of Pearl Harbor. One advanced seaplane squadron even sent a signal to its headquarters, requesting that all future mail should be directed to Midway. The results of war games, simulating the coming battle, were also ignored. When one such game resulted in the intervention of American bombers from Midway Island and the sinking of two Japanese carriers, the outcome was deemed unacceptable and was overruled by the umpire. For the massive undertaking that would expand the Japanese Empire and destroy the US Navy in the Pacific, Japan could muster almost its entire combined fleet. All nine of the fleet's battleships, along with 11 carriers, would take part in the coming operations. Of these, four carriers would eventually participate in the Battle of Midway. Akagi, or Red Castle, was laid down as a battlecruiser in 1920. 2 years later, she was converted into an aircraft carrier. In 1934, Akagi was extensively modified to accommodate 30 more aircraft, taking her battle complement to 91. Akagi was one of only two carriers ever built, with the bridge on the port side. Kaga, or Increased Joy, was originally laid down as a battleship, but in 1924, work began to convert her to a carrier. She was completed in March 1928. Later, Kaga's triple deck was replaced by a much lengthened single deck in a major refit. Her aircraft capacity was raised from 60 to 90. Soryu, the Green Dragon, was launched in December 1935. Built under the limitations of the Washington Naval Treaty, Soryu was small and cramped. Nevertheless, she could still carry 63 aircraft, and the design was so successful, she was the model for nearly all later Japanese carriers. Hiryu, the Flying Dragon, like Akagi, had her bridge on the port side. Because of the universal tendency of pilots to veer left in an emergency, the design caused many more landing accidents. Hiryu was, however, very much more seaworthy than her predecessors. Her complement of aircraft was 63. The Mitsubishi A6M-0 fighter was the most potent and visible symbol of Japanese prowess in the Pacific War. Purpose-designed as a Navy fighter to operate from land bases and aircraft carriers, the Zero would acquire an awesome reputation. The Zero had a remarkably clean airframe and was very light in weight. The result was high speed and excellent fuel economy. However, these advantages were achieved at the expense of pilot protection. The Zero had no armor and no self-sealing fuel tanks. More Zeros would be built than any other type of Japanese aircraft. The Aichi D-3A VAL-2-seater was the first all-metal monoplane dive bomber to enter Japanese naval service. In the hands of experts, the Val was a formidable weapon, realizing an 80% strike accuracy during the early Japanese conquests. The Val was so strongly built and so highly maneuverable that even with a fixed, spatted undercarriage, it could become a highly effective fighter once it had dropped its bombs. Although the Nakajima B-5N Kate was slow and poorly protected, it was, at the time of Midway, the best aircraft of its type in the world. On its introduction in 1937, it had boasted many advanced features, such as folding wings, a retractable undercarriage, and integral wing fuel tanks. Effective as a conventional bomber, as a torpedo bomber, the Kate was devastating. The aircraft was armed with the excellent Type 91 torpedo. The Type 91 could be dropped at 200 miles per hour and from a height of up to 300 meters. A valuable protection against anti-aircraft fire. The naval pilots preparing for New Guinea and Midway operations were seasoned veterans of the attack on Pearl Harbor. They had gone on to fly combat missions in the Pacific and Indian Oceans. For Japanese pilots, the intervals between combat operations were entirely taken up by training. The motto was train hard, fight easy. Japanese determination to achieve the highest standards in Navy flying had not come without a price. Pilot training was lengthy and expensive. Only 100 naval pilots graduated each year from the training schools. Far too few to cope with the incessant demands placed on Japanese carrier forces. Since the start of the war, there had been no leave for Navy aircrew. The training of Japanese sailors and flight deck personnel was, if anything, even more arduous than that undergone by their pilot comrades. The men were conscripts, hardened by harsh discipline, and ceaseless battle drill meant that a ship could be brought to action stations and a complete strike force launched within 5 minutes. During the heat of battle, a flight could be rearmed, refueled, and airborne again within 1 hour. Although the combat readiness of Japanese sailors and airmen was unsurpassed, there was an underlying weakness in the Navy's preparation for the coming operations. Before Pearl Harbor, air crew had been able to practice 4 bomb runs a day, and dive bombers had been expected to score 80% hit rates or better. There had also been extensive fleet maneuvers. Now, with the fuel shortages that had triggered the war worse than ever, maneuvers and bombing practice were restricted. At Midway, the consequences for the Imperial Navy would be nothing short of catastrophic. Soon after the attack on Pearl Harbor, it had become clear to senior American naval commanders that although the damage done was severe, it was far from the fatal blow the Japanese had intended. The Pacific Fleet's priceless aircraft carriers had escaped. The Japanese had failed to destroy ship repair yards, and they had ignored the base's fuel depots, leaving vast supplies of oil intact. In spite of Japanese efforts, Pearl Harbor still played host to a powerful American naval presence. Hawaii was the base for the United States' 3 Pacific Fleet carriers, plus a 4th transferred from the Atlantic fleet. Each carrier was supported by its screen of up to 2 heavy cruisers and 5 destroyers. Nearly 20 submarines protected the waters around Oahu and Midway Island. Because Admiral Nimitz was convinced that the overwhelming superiority of the Japanese Navy ruled out anything but a hit-and-run attack, the slow Pacific Fleet battleships would play no part in the coming operation. Those that had been repaired after the Pearl Harbor attack were sent to San Francisco to patrol the west coast of the United States. Everything would now depend on the speed and long-range hitting power of American aircraft carriers. All 3 of the carriers that would take part in the Battle of Midway were of the Yorktown class. Commissioned by October 1941, the ships were Yorktown, Hornet, and Enterprise. Although slightly slower than its Japanese equivalent, the Yorktown class was capable of carrying an extra 20 aircraft. Yorktown carriers were notable for their advanced damage control systems. To minimize the risk of fire, aviation gas fuel lines could be filled with carbon dioxide when an enemy attack was imminent. The carrier's decks were also specially designed for combat conditions. The flight deck was unarmored and constructed with 6-inch planks of teak, more easily repaired than metal, and less likely to cause severe splinter wounds to crewmen. Unlike Japanese carriers, the Yorktowns were all equipped with radar, which could detect aircraft flying up to 30,000 feet and at a range of over 100 miles. Although the Lexington would not take part in the Midway battle, she would play a vital role in a preliminary action, the Battle of the Coral Sea. Lexington had been laid down as a battle cruiser in 1921 and converted during construction. She emerged as America's first fleet carrier and one of the largest aircraft carriers in the world. Because Lexington was of a very early design, her available deck and hangar space was not efficiently used, and her aircraft complement was a modest 63. Originally designed as a biplane carrier fighter, the Grumman Wildcat had been replanned on the drawing board as a mid-wing monoplane. The aircraft entered US Navy service in 1939 and was manufactured first by Grumman and later by General Motors. Powered by a Wright Cyclone 9-cylinder radial engine, the Wildcat was slower than its opposite number, the Zero. However, its maneuverability, heavy 6-gun armament, effective armor, and rugged construction meant that Wildcats could often survive battle damage that would spell disaster for any other fighter. Nearly 8,000 Wildcats would see service in World War II. From its introduction in June 1940, the Douglas Dauntless was one of the most important American combat aircraft of the war. In the first half of 1942, the Dauntless saw more action than any other type. The Dauntless was a dive bomber with heavy armor, a bulletproof windscreen, and self-sealing fuel tanks. It was powered by a 9-cylinder Wright Cyclone radial engine. Because of its great stability in flight, the aircraft was known affectionately to its pilots as the Barge. When it first entered service with the US Navy, the Dauntless was the best carrier-based dive bomber in the world. The aircraft would be responsible for sinking more Japanese shipping than any other Allied weapon, and at Midway would account for all Japanese ship losses. The three-man Douglas Devastator, America's first carrier monoplane, had entered service in 1937, and by 1942 was already obsolete. It was slow, lightly armed, and had a poor rate of climb. At Midway, Devastators would suffer appalling losses, and the battle would be the aircraft's last major action of the war. The Grumman TBF was planned as a replacement for the Devastator, and although designed very quickly, it would prove to be the most successful torpedo bomber of World War II. The TBF was a robust and powerful three-seater aircraft. It was the first American naval warplane to mount a power-operated turret, and the only one to carry its torpedo internally. The TBF entered service early in 1942, but only six were available for the Battle of Midway. All were stationed on Midway Island. It would be the TBF's first combat action, and in memory of the men lost during the battle, the aircraft would afterwards be renamed the Avenger. The consolidated PBY Catalina would become one of the most successful flying boats of World War II and the most numerous flying boat ever. The Catalina was unique as the first flying boat to feature cantilever wings which needed no supporting spars. It also had stabilizing floats which could be retracted to form the wingtips in flight. The resulting aerodynamic efficiency made for speed and long range. After the first four marks of PBY flying boat, the aircraft was fitted with retractable tricycle landing gear to give it an amphibious capability. Although able to carry a heavy bomb load, in the Battle of Midway, it would be the long-range reconnaissance capability of the Catalina that would prove invaluable to the Americans. During the battle, Catalinas would also save the lives of many ditched American flyers. The B-17, a four-engined heavy bomber, had first entered service with the United States Army in June 1939. Although the aircraft would win fame as a strategic bomber, for political reasons, the original specification was for a long-range anti-shipping weapon, the role it would in fact play in the Battle of Midway. The B-17E fully lived up to its designation as a flying fortress. Intended to operate in self-defending formations, the B-17E mounted two hydraulically operated turrets, one of them a retractable ball underneath the aircraft. Altogether, the fortress carried 11 machine guns and was fitted with self-sealing fuel tanks and extensive armor. For such a large and powerful aircraft, the B-17 had a low wing loading and even with heavy combat damage, was more likely to get its crew home than any other comparable aircraft. In the Battle of Midway, 19 B-17s of the US Army Air Force would operate against the Japanese. To extend their range, they would carry extra fuel tanks and half their normal bomb load. The Japanese attack on Pearl Harbor had united the American people at a single stroke. Military and civilians alike shared a bitter resolve to see the Japanese totally defeated. Across the country, hundreds of thousands flocked to the recruitment centers. The Japanese blow had been most keenly felt by the men of the United States Navy, and the humiliation had given an extraordinary edge to even the most prosaic of training exercises. Unlike the Japanese, whose trainee naval pilots were an elite, selected at 14 years of age, the Americans recruited from a much wider segment of the population. In the United States, there were far more suitably educated recruits with the right mental and physical qualities for a carrier pilot. On America's entry into the war, the training schools were easily expanded without any appreciable fall-off in quality. After 3 months of elementary flying instruction, the aspiring naval pilot spent another 3 months in basic Navy training. Periods at two more flight schools followed, and only the best were then selected for training as carrier pilots. In spite of the excellence of US Navy flight training, American carrier pilots would go into battle with little more than half of the 700 hours flying time acquired by their Japanese counterparts. They had also, as yet, seen little combat. Some had taken part in raids on the Gilbert and Marshall Islands, which had been mounted as much for training and morale as for any strategic reasons. But the actions had been minor and had met little serious opposition. As for flight deck crew, American performance was at least as effective as the Japanese. The men were just as capable of launching a wave of strike aircraft within 5 minutes. Where the Americans did have a real edge on the enemy was in damage control. Damage control parties were highly trained in their duties, and their ability to deal with fire, the greatest threat to any warship, was unsurpassed. At the Battle of Midway, the relative damage control skills of each side would prove a key factor in deciding the outcome of the fight. By late April 1942, preparations for the Japanese campaign were well underway. Naval facilities at the port of Rabaul had been greatly expanded, and thousands of troops had been assembled, ready for the conquest of New Guinea and Tulagi. The troop transports were ready to sail, along with their escorts of cruisers and destroyers. The Japanese anticipated little opposition on Tulagi, and once the island had been captured, the Port Moresby assault would follow. In both cases, the Japanese expected that surprise would be on their side. As the three Japanese aircraft carriers, which had assembled at Truk, prepared to carry out their orders, one to escort the Port Moresby invasion force, and the other two to take up stations in the Coral Sea. The Americans acted decisively. A task force, based around the carriers Yorktown and Lexington, was sent racing to intercept the Japanese. On May the 1st, south of the Solomon Islands, the carriers rendezvoused with a powerful force of Australian cruisers. The stage was set for the Battle of the Coral Sea, the first clash in an epic confrontation that would change the course of the Pacific War. The capture of the island of Tulagi on May the 3rd, 1942, was, as the Japanese expected, simply a matter of dropping anchor and disembarking the troops. Tulagi's tiny garrison of Australians had already been evacuated. The first blow in Japan's great campaign of expansion had apparently gone strictly to plan. What the Japanese did not know was that the American carrier, Yorktown, with Admiral Fletcher on board, had been informed of events on Tulagi and was already steaming north. At 7 a.m. on the morning after the Tulagi landings, Yorktown struck. 40 of Fletcher's aircraft were launched against the anchored Japanese fleet and the occupation force. In a little over an hour, the American bombers and torpedo bombers had sunk or damaged a destroyer, three minesweepers, a number of landing craft, and several seaplanes. For the Japanese, it was the first unsettling evidence that American carriers lurked in the area. On only the second day of operations, events were already taking an ominous turn. By the following day, Yorktown and her escorts had returned to rendezvous with Lexington. The two escort groups now merged to form a single screen around the carriers. They had joined forces only just in time. The Japanese carriers, Shokaku and Zuikaku, had entered the Coral Sea, and the two fleets were just 70 miles apart. On the morning of May the 7th, the American carrier task force with Lexington and Yorktown was cruising on a northwesterly course. The Japanese carriers, Shokaku and Zuikaku, were sailing on a parallel course. Each fleet was unaware of the other's presence. American scout planes sent to the northeast failed to find the Japanese carriers, but a scout sent to the northwest reported a sighting. At once, the Americans launched a strike force of 93 aircraft. In fact, the ships sighted were the cruisers and destroyers of the New Guinea invasion force. But soon the carrier Shoho was spotted, only 25 miles away, and the attack was redirected. Shoho was hit by 13 bombs and 7 torpedoes. She sank within minutes. For the Imperial Navy, the loss of Shoho was deeply traumatic. So shocked were Japanese commanders that the invasion of Port Moresby was immediately cancelled, and the troop ships turned back to Rabaul. On the American side, there was jubilation. A pilot's radio report of the Shoho sinking, Scratch One Flat Top, would become the most famous signal of the Pacific War. After the sinking of the Shoho, Admiral Fletcher did not immediately launch another strike against the Japanese invasion fleet. To attack the carriers Shokaku and Zuikaku was his main objective, and in any case, the Japanese might themselves attack, and he would need his air defense at full strength. As the day advanced, a weather front closed in on the Japanese carriers. Nevertheless, the strike force commander, Admiral Tagaki, was determined to destroy the Americans before they could inflict yet more damage on the retreating Japanese invasion fleet. Choosing his best night flyers, Tagaki launched his attack in the late afternoon. The aircraft would have to return and land in darkness. The Japanese raiders, in spite of the poor weather, passed close to the American carrier group. The Americans, with the benefit of radar, easily detected the enemy formations and vectored their fighters to intercept. In a series of vicious dogfights, 10 Japanese aircraft were shot down. 11 more would crash after the mission, trying to land in darkness. For the Japanese, the raid was a fiasco. In the aftermath of this first carrier clash between the Imperial Navy and the US Pacific Fleet, both sides considered attacking by night with their cruisers and destroyers. Both finally rejected the idea, fearing the absence of their protective screens. Instead, they withdrew, postponing the main action for another day. On the morning of May the 8th, the American and Japanese fleets were more than 100 miles apart. The Japanese had the benefit of low cloud cover, while the Americans were exposed under clear blue skies. At 0600, both sides launched their reconnaissance aircraft, and within 2 hours, each fleet had discovered the other. On the American side, Yorktown and Lexington launched 70 bombers and torpedo bombers and 6 fighters. At almost the same time, Shokaku and Zuikaku launched 50 attack aircraft and 20 fighters. Although the Japanese carriers were close together, Zuikaku was hidden by cloud, and it was Shokaku who fell victim to the Americans. She was hit by 3 bombs, and so badly damaged that she would later be unable to recover her aircraft. Most would be forced to ditch in the sea. The American carriers, using their radar, detected the approaching Japanese raiders 70 miles away. 12 Wildcat fighters were scrambled, but only 3 reached a high enough altitude to attack, and no Japanese aircraft were destroyed. Yorktown was first to be hit. A single bomb found its target. The next victim was the larger and less maneuverable Lexington. 2 bombs struck her deck, inflicting minor damage. But far more seriously, 2 torpedoes impacted on her port side. Even after the Japanese bombs and torpedoes had struck, Lexington continued to fight. But soon after the battle, she began to list to port. By pumping oil from one side of the carrier to the other, the crew managed to right the vessel, and she was soon capable of maintaining 24 knots. It looked as if Lexington might still be able to reach home under her own steam. However, at 14:45, an explosion ripped through the carrier, and soon fires were raging out of control. The order was given to abandon ship, and after her crew had been taken off, a destroyer was detailed to sink the blazing hulk with torpedoes. 38 aircraft were still on board. The destruction of Lexington meant that the Battle of the Coral Sea was a tactical victory for the Japanese. The light carrier Shoho had been exchanged for the far more formidable Lexington. However, the Imperial Navy had been far more badly damaged than it seemed. The carrier Shokaku was out of action, and Zuikaku's aircrew had been slaughtered. As a result, neither carrier would be able to participate in the decisive battle soon to be fought at Midway. In the aftermath of the Coral Sea battle, the Japanese made a fatal error. They knew they had sunk the Lexington, but they also believed that Yorktown had been smashed beyond repair. Even with two of their own heavy carriers out of action and the loss of the Shoho, they were certain that the balance was still in their favor. The remaining Japanese carriers, supported by battleships and heavy cruisers, would still have more than enough firepower to send the American Pacific Fleet to the bottom of the ocean. The Japanese main force for the Battle of Midway was based in Hashirajima in Japan. The main force was commanded by Admiral Yamamoto himself. Yamamoto had 7 battleships, 3 light cruisers, 2 seaplane carriers, 1 light carrier, and 20 destroyers. Attached to the main force was Admiral Chuichi Nagumo's carrier strike force, the most powerful carrier fleet in the world. His heavy carriers, Hiryu, Soryu, Akagi, and Kaga, would be escorted by 2 fast battleships, 3 cruisers, and 11 destroyers. The Midway invasion force was commanded by Admiral Nobutake Kondo. Its main body was made up of 2 battleships, 4 heavy cruisers, 1 light carrier, and 7 destroyers. Subordinate to Admiral Kondo was the Midway Occupation Force, commanded by Rear Admiral Raiso Tanaka. Tanaka had 12 transports with 5,000 troops and a screen of 1 light cruiser, 10 destroyers, and 3 patrol boats. At Guam in the Marianas was the Midway Support Force, under the command of Rear Admiral Takeo Kurita. Kurita had 4 heavy cruisers and 2 destroyers. As well as his Midway forces, Admiral Yamamoto had overall command of the Aleutian's fleet, based in the anchorage at Ominato on the northern island of the Japanese homeland. The northern force was made up of a carrier striking force with 1 heavy and 1 light carrier, 2 cruisers, and 3 destroyers. There was also an invasion fleet of 4 transports carrying 1,000 soldiers, accompanied by a 7-strong destroyer screen. With the Lexington sunk and Yorktown badly damaged in the Coral Sea, the US Pacific Fleet had been critically weakened. Yorktown went into dry dock in Pearl Harbor, with damage estimated to need at least 3 months to repair. In fact, the yards achieved near miraculous results. The job was done in 3 days, with 1,500 men working around the clock. Much minor damage had not yet been put right, and as the carrier sailed, scores of dockyard crew remained on board. Admiral Chester Nimitz, overall commander of the US Pacific Fleet, would stay in Pearl Harbor throughout the Battle of Midway, communicating with his ships by radio. Nimitz divided his carriers into two task forces. Task Force 17 was commanded by Admiral Frank Fletcher, veteran of the Coral Sea. Fletcher had Yorktown as his flagship, two cruisers and 6 destroyers. Fletcher also had operational command of Task Force 16, led by Admiral Raymond Spruance. Spruance had the carriers Enterprise and Hornet, along with 2 cruisers and 11 destroyers. From Pearl Harbor, Admiral Nimitz deployed 19 submarines for reconnaissance and attack, which would patrol off Midway and Hawaii. He would also call on aircraft based on the island of Midway itself. The US Army Air Force had 4 B-26 and 19 B-17E bombers. The Marines fielded 20 Buffalo and 7 Wildcat fighters. They also had 11 Vindicator and 16 Dauntless bombers. The Navy had 38 Catalinas and 6 TBF torpedo bombers. The island was also defended by the 6th Marine Defense Battalion of 3,000 men. On the morning of May the 27th, the Japanese carrier strike force, under Admiral Nagumo, sailed from Hashirajima. By nightfall, they had entered the Pacific and were heading for Midway. The following day, the Aleutians invasion force and the main body of warships sorted from Ominato. At the same time, far to the south, the Midway invasion force with its escort of destroyers and the invasion support force of heavy cruisers sorted from the Marianas. Last to leave port on the 29th were the invasion force main body and Yamamoto's fleet, each of battleships, cruisers and destroyers. Although Admiral Nimitz and his senior commanders knew that Midway was to be invaded, for security reasons, no one on the island was told that the mightiest concentration of naval power in history was bearing down upon them. Piecemeal, Midway's marine garrison was reinforced, and the island's anti-aircraft defenses were strengthened. Every day, the Catalina flying boats patrolled the ocean around the island in greater numbers, although none of their crew yet knew precisely what they were searching for. The Japanese, too, had begun their reconnaissance effort. An advanced submarine force had been at sea for many days, racing towards Hawaii. Its task would be to set up a picket north of Pearl Harbor and report the strength of any American fleet dispatched to Midway. The submarines were, in fact, already too late. On May the 28th, Task Force 16 left Pearl Harbor unobserved, followed by Task Force 17 on the 30th. Both groups vanished into the Pacific Ocean, and the Japanese submarines, which would finally arrive on June the 3rd, would watch in vain. By June the 2nd, the Japanese Northern Force was ploughing its way through the North Pacific towards the Aleutians. The islands, although of immense strategic importance to the United States, were sparsely manned, the only forces of any consequence deployed at Dutch Harbor. The Americans, expecting the Japanese attack, flew repeated reconnaissance missions, but because of poor weather, failed to locate the enemy. The Japanese at first fared little better, but a second strike group did succeed in bombing Dutch Harbor. Over the following days, troops of the Special Naval Landing Force occupied Kiska and Attu. Although the Aleutians' operation was, in tactical terms, a complete success, and the Japanese occupation of the islands would be a thorn in the American side for some time to come, the primary objective of the invasion had failed. The Americans, instead of dispatching strong naval forces north, away from Midway, ignored the diversion. A key element in the Japanese plan failed completely. While the Japanese Northern Force was launching its attack on the Aleutians, hundreds of miles to the south, Nagumo's carrier strike force was fast approaching Midway. 200 miles behind were Yamamoto's main force battleships and steaming from the southwest, the Midway invasion fleet. With no cloud cover, the invasion flotilla was desperately exposed. And by now, Midway's Catalinas were sweeping a huge arc of ocean, out to 700 miles, covering all the likely approaches to the island. It was on June the 3rd, at 09:04, that a Catalina made the first sighting of Japanese ships off Midway. The pilot reported two cargo vessels. 21 minutes later, another Catalina, flown by Ensign Jack Reed, and just beyond the extreme limit of its allotted search, spotted a large formation of ships. The message dispatched to Midway read, "Sighted main body," and a few minutes later, gave its bearing and range. Although the distance, 700 miles, was within the capabilities of Midway's B-17 bombers, which already had their extra fuel tanks fitted and were armed and waiting, Midway's commanders were unwilling to commit their forces without more information. It would be another 2 hours of steadily mounting tension before a radio message confirmed the sighting of a large body of Japanese warships. Meanwhile, reports of the sighting were passed to the American carriers. The two American carrier task forces were waiting 325 miles to the northeast of Midway. The Catalina's report placed the Japanese main body to the southwest. However, Nimitz was confident of his intelligence sources and certain that the ships were only the Japanese invasion force. Nimitz signaled his commanders, The carrier strike force will hit from the northwest tomorrow. Fletcher ordered Enterprise and Hornet to change course, and both task forces headed south to lie in wait. With the sighting of the Japanese invasion fleet confirmed, Midway's B-17s were finally given the order to attack. At 12:25 hours, nine bombers lumbered down the island's runway to launch the first attack of the Battle of Midway. It would take over 4 hours for the B-17s to reach the enemy fleet and begin their high-level runs. Because of their extra fuel tanks, the fortresses were carrying only 36 500-pound bombs between them. None struck home. From altitude, the effects were hard to judge, and the crews reported hits on six vessels, including two battleships. In the aftermath, the US Army Air Force would claim a major victory for land-based high-level bombers. Throughout the night of June the 3rd, the atmosphere on Midway was tense but confident. The reports of the B-17 crews were encouraging. Everyone believed that at least some damage had been done to the Japanese fleet. During the night, a Catalina torpedo attack on the invasion transports did succeed in hitting one Japanese oiler. Insignificant in real terms, but heartening for the waiting Marines. At first light, Midway's Catalinas were once more dispatched on their reconnaissance patrols. Because a Japanese raid on the airfield was almost certain, the B-17s were ordered to take off once more to prevent them being caught on the ground. As the Japanese carrier strike force steamed at 24 knots on its final run into Midway, sailors and aircrew prepared themselves for the ordeal ahead with the traditional toasts and worship at the Shinto shrine on board every Japanese warship. All were keenly aware that they were about to strike the first major blow in a battle on which depended not only their own lives, but the future of the Japanese Empire. At 04:30, Admiral Nagumo turned his carriers into the wind and launched his first strike wave, 108 aircraft in all. The rest, including his most experienced aircrew, were held in reserve in case any American warships were discovered. Nagumo believed the possibility extremely remote, so only after his first wave had been sent to Midway did he order his reconnaissance aircraft to begin their search of the surrounding ocean. The search, mounted by the Japanese carrier strike force, was conducted by only 7 aircraft from 5 ships. Okagi and Kaga each launched one VAL at 04:30. Both aircraft were to search 300 miles out and could cover an area 60 miles wide. At the same time, the battleship Haruna launched one float plane with a range of 150 miles. The cruisers Tone and Chikuma were each to dispatch two float planes, but technical problems delayed Tone's aircraft for up to half an hour, and one of Chikuma's developed engine trouble and would have to turn back. The search was dangerously incomplete. As the Japanese scouted for American carriers, Midway's Catalinas were, in their turn, looking for the Japanese. At 0530, a single enemy carrier was sighted. On Midway Island and on the ships of the American task forces, the effect was electrifying. The Japanese were exactly where Admiral Nimitz had expected them to be. Shortly after the first sighting, one more vital piece of information was received from the Catalinas. A wave of strike aircraft was approaching the island. To Admiral Spruance, on board Enterprise, it was a priceless piece of information. Soon after the aircraft had hit Midway, the Japanese carriers would have to retrieve them for rearming and refueling. At that point, the carriers would be supremely vulnerable. As the Japanese strike wave came within range of Midway radar, all the island's remaining aircraft were scrambled. When the enemy arrived, the runways and hangars would be clear. Midway's fighters would be waiting to meet them, and the island's force of bombers and torpedo bombers would already be on their way to strike back at the Japanese carriers. In spite of the valiant efforts of Midway's mostly obsolete fighters, the Japanese bombers and dive bombers broke through without having lost a single aircraft. However, as soon as the lead attackers came within range of the island's anti-aircraft guns, they were met by a hail of fire. Finding no American planes on the ground, the bombers attacked and destroyed Midway's oil tanks on Sand Island. At the same time, the dive bombers targeted the airfield and hangars on Eastern Island and destroyed virtually every building in sight. With 15 of Midway's defending fighters already shot down, the Japanese fighters were now free to strafe ground targets. They too met a murderous hail of anti-aircraft fire. In all, 6 Japanese aircraft would fall to Midway's guns. When the Japanese headed back to their carriers at 0643, it was already apparent to the strike leader that although they had left behind a trail of destruction, they had not succeeded in their primary objective. By radio, he reported that most of Midway's aircraft had escaped and the island's runways remained largely intact. Midway's bombers were still a serious threat to the Japanese fleet. Even before the strike wave had returned to its carriers, Admiral Nagumo was ordering a second attack on the island. Only moments later, there was dramatic confirmation of the threat Midway's aircraft posed to Nagumo's carriers. 6 American TBF torpedo bombers and 4 B-26 medium bombers suddenly bore down on the Japanese carrier fleet. The screening destroyers and cruisers put up a storm of anti-aircraft fire. At the same time, 10 Zero fighters of Akagi's combat air patrol swooped in to attack. The TBFs did succeed in launching at Akagi, but violent maneuvering saved the Japanese carrier. Savaged by the Zeros and by furious anti-aircraft fire, only one TBF and two B-26s survived the raid. At almost the same time as the Japanese fleet was beating off the first wave of attackers from Midway, the American task forces were preparing to launch their own strike waves. Reconnaissance had now confirmed that there were not one, but two enemy carriers in the area. Such a target was simply too good a chance to miss. The latest reconnaissance placed the two Japanese carriers over 200 miles from the Americans. The maximum range for an airstrike was around 150 miles, so the first priority was to close the gap. Assuming that Nagumo's carriers would still be steaming towards Midway, Fletcher set a course to intercept. Only Spruance's Task Force 16, with Enterprise and Hornet, was to be sent. Task Force 17, with Yorktown, would wait to recover her scout planes and follow later. If the Americans were to catch the Japanese as they rearmed aircraft returning from the attack on Midway, they would have to launch their first strike wave around 0700 hours. Although the range was closing quickly, it was still too great for the Devastator torpedo bombers to strike and return home. They would be sent regardless. Those that survived the raid would have to ditch in the sea. Altogether, Hornet and Enterprise launched 29 Devastator torpedo bombers and 72 Dauntless dive bombers. For fighter cover, there were 20 Wildcats. Admiral Spruance was aware that only two of at least four Japanese carriers had been located, and kept 36 fighters to defend his task force from any Japanese counterattack. As the strike groups from Hornet and Enterprise set course for the enemy fleet, Yorktown, her scout planes now recovered, raced to catch up with Task Force 16. At 0838, Admiral Fletcher launched his strike aircraft. Within half an hour, the total number of American aircraft heading for the Japanese fleet had reached 156. Even now, the Japanese were still unaware that they had been found and targeted by enemy carriers. Nagumo's men were toiling to prepare their aircraft for the second raid on Midway, and the Admiral was confident his fleet was secure. His scout planes had been out almost 2 hours and had reported no sign of an American task force. In fact, Japanese reconnaissance had been a disastrous failure. By now, Task Force 16, steaming towards Nagumo's fleet, was well inside the search area of the Japanese scout planes. However, Chikuma's float plane had flown right past the Americans and had failed to spot them. Because Tone's scout could not search the same area until the return leg of its flight, and had been delayed by half an hour to begin with, the error was not detected for a considerable time. When it was, at 0725, the pilot's report mentioned only enemy surface ships. As a result, Nagumo now believed there was no immediate threat from American carriers. At 0748, as the Japanese were just about to launch the second Midway strike, they themselves suddenly came under attack. It was another raid from Midway Island. First came 16 dauntless dive bombers, whose inexperienced pilots approached in a shallow glide. The Zeros of Nagumo's combat air patrol destroyed half their number before they even reached the carriers. Next came Midway's B-17s, dropping their bombs from 20,000 feet. Not a single Japanese vessel was hit. Midway's marine vindicators were equally unsuccessful. As the American raiders headed home, and Nagumo once more turned into the wind to launch his second wave against Midway, dramatic news was reported by a scout plane. The pilot had spotted a carrier. For Nagumo, the revelation could not have come at a worse moment. While the Japanese second wave was preparing to launch, Nagumo's first wave, just returned from Midway, was circling, waiting to land. Also waiting to refuel and rearm were the fleet's Zero fighters, which had been in action protecting the carriers. If Nagumo were to launch his second wave against the reported enemy carrier, they would have to go without fighter cover. Nagumo decided to wait. He would return his second wave below decks, recover his circling aircraft for refueling, then launch a full-scale attack on the American fleet. At 0917, with all their aircraft recovered, the Japanese carriers, up to now heading towards Midway, turned east-northeast to close with the American force. Nagumo's strike would be ready to launch at 10:30 hours. As the Japanese surged ahead at 30 knots, the decks of Nagumo's carriers were chaotic. Flight crew struggled frantically to refuel and rearm their aircraft. Bombs and torpedoes lay everywhere, and there was no time to follow safety procedures. And unknown to the Japanese, who had no radar, the first American torpedo bombers were only 3 minutes away. The American air group from Task Force 16 had followed a course based on the assumption that the Japanese fleet had carried on sailing towards Midway. Instead, Nagumo had changed course. As a result, most of the dive bombers and fighters from Hornet, 45 aircraft in all, failed to find the enemy. A second group of Hornet's aircraft had also, at first, missed Nagumo's fleet, but had then turned north and within minutes had found the Japanese carriers. The first target for Hornet's torpedo bombers was Akagi. As the squadron swept in at low level, the Zeros pounced. The few Americans that survived were torn apart by the fleet's anti-aircraft fire. Not one torpedo bomber and only one pilot survived. Within minutes of the first raid, torpedo bombers from Enterprise and Yorktown began their attack. Once again, the American pilots were slaughtered, and no enemy ships were hit. Only six raiders survived. With the torpedo attacks beaten off and his fleet still unscathed, Nagumo was at last ready to send his waiting strike aircraft against the American carriers. Just as the launch signal was about to be given, American dive bombers, which had been lurking high in the clouds, pounced on the carriers. The first victim was Kaga. The time was 10:20 hours. The first bomb to strike Kaga landed on the rear of her flight deck, squarely amongst aircraft, armed and waiting to take off. Two more hit near her forward elevator. Another exploded in the hangar below, igniting fuel and detonating bombs. Kaga was left a raging inferno within minutes, and almost everyone on her bridge was killed. As Kaga burned, Akagi was launching its first Zero fighter for the attack that was supposed to smash the American fleet. At that moment, three dauntless dive bombers struck. The first hit on Akagi landed near her midships lift and exploded in the hangar. The next fell amongst the parked aircraft on her deck. Fuel and bombs ignited immediately, killing the elite of the Japanese air fleet in their cockpits. Within minutes, the fire had spread forward, and Admiral Nagumo's flagship was doomed. The next victim of the American dive bombers was Soryu. Just after 10:25, three bombs smashed into the carrier's flight deck. The first bomb fell between Soryu's second and third lifts. The next landed in front of the forward lift and penetrated to the hangar, detonating bombs, torpedoes, and fuel. The third struck on the rear deck, completely destroying her waiting strike wave. In the space of 5 minutes, the mightiest carrier fleet in existence had been shattered. Admiral Nagumo, his flagship blazing, was forced to transfer his flag to a cruiser. Of his once magnificent carrier force, only Hiryu was left, and immediately the order was given to launch her strike aircraft. There was still some hope that even now, a devastating blow could be visited on the American enemy. The first wave of Hiryu's strike force was made up of 18 Val dive bombers and 6 Zero fighters. Their target was Task Force 17 and the carrier Yorktown. Shortly before noon, the Vals were detected by Yorktown's radar. Already, 12 Wildcat fighters were in the air covering the carrier, and another 15 were on deck refueling. These were ordered to launch at once. At the same time, Yorktown's aviation gas lines were shut down, and her fire suppression system was activated. The Japanese strike wave, approaching at 10,000 feet, ran straight into Yorktown's fighter defenses. 10 were shot down by the Wildcats. The 14 survivors headed straight for the American carrier. Five Vals survived the gauntlet of Wildcats and the hail of fire put up by Yorktown and her escorts. Three bombs plunged into Fletcher's flagship. The first bomb struck Yorktown's flight deck and exploded. The second penetrated and burst below the funnel, damaging all but one of the ship's boilers and destroying her radar room. The third bomb crashed through Yorktown's number one elevator and deep into her hangar. In spite of being hit by three bombs, so good was Yorktown's damage control that potentially catastrophic fires were quickly put out. No fuel or magazines exploded, and amazingly, Yorktown was steaming at 20 knots and able to recover and relaunch her fighters within 1 hour and 40 minutes of the attack. By now, the surviving Japanese carrier, Hiryu, had launched her second wave, a scratch force of 10 Kate torpedo bombers and 6 Zero fighters. Once again, American Wildcats savaged the raiders, but 9 torpedo bombers survived and swept into the attack. Because Yorktown was no longer belching smoke, she was mistaken for one of her unscathed sister ships. Although 5 more Kates were destroyed by anti-aircraft fire, 4 launched their torpedoes. Yorktown was hit twice on the port side, and one of the raiders deliberately crashed onto her deck. Within seconds of the strike, Yorktown was racked by explosions and began to list to port. At 1500 hours, the order was given to abandon ship. As the first of Yorktown's crew were being taken off by her attendant destroyers, aboard Enterprise, Admiral Spruance received news from a scout aircraft that Hiryu had been spotted. The Japanese carrier was 100 miles northwest of the dying Yorktown. At 15:30, Enterprise launched 24 dauntless dive bombers and Hornet another 16. Meanwhile, Hiryu was recovering and refueling her last remaining aircraft for a third strike against the American carriers. At 17:05, the Dauntlesses, undetected by Hiryu's combat air patrol, screamed down out of the sun. Hiryu maneuvered violently, but 4 bombs found their target. The first 2 bombs to hit blew Hiryu's number one lift clean off and left the whole forward deck a mass of flame. The other 2 penetrated to the hangar, where bombs and fuel exploded violently. The waiting aircraft at the rear of the flight deck blew up, killing almost all their pilots. Admiral Nagumo's last carrier was finished, and with her, Japanese domination of the skies over the Pacific. When Admiral Yamamoto learned of the catastrophe that had befallen his fleet, he did not at once abandon all hope. Perhaps, with the awesome firepower of his battleships and cruisers, he could yet destroy the Americans in a night battle. Yamamoto was clutching at straws. That evening, American carriers sailed eastward, and Yamamoto could no longer force a battle before daylight exposed his ships to air attack. At 02:55, on the morning of June the 5th, Admiral Yamamoto ordered a general withdrawal. On the morning of June the 6th, strike waves from Enterprise and Hornet added to the American tally of four Japanese carriers by sinking one cruiser and damaging another. With them, the number of Japanese dead rose to 3,500 men. On the American side, the cost of victory was the carrier Yorktown, finally sunk by torpedoes from a prowling Japanese submarine, and the destroyer Hammond that had been lying alongside. In all, 307 aircrew, sailors, and marines had died. For the United States, the Battle of Midway would prove the turning point in the fight against Japan. Unable to replace her losses in carriers and aircrew, the Japanese Empire would never again be capable of taking the initiative. Japan had not only suffered the greatest defeat in her history, but had, in a single day, lost the Pacific War.